And we're going to start, instead of having me introduce, we'll do a little video, a couple minutes long. So as we put this video together at the beginning of the year, as I listened to some of the numbers, it's amazing how quickly things change and just tagging through. So since that video was produced, we have installed almost another 200 megawatts. So our company has doubled the size of our capacity in the last 8 or 9 months. This is September, so we'll say 9 months. And we're one of Asheville's larger companies, North Carolina's largest companies, and not a lot of people know what we actually do. So it's kind of a great way to show how many people are familiar with solar energy. So a good portion. And I thought, instead of going into a lot of that detail, I'd try to tailor this a little bit to understanding maybe what you guys want to get out of the class here a little bit, and maybe towards our story, because we've been through a lot, ups and downs. I was just asked, how come our employment numbers are down from where they were in 2007, 2010? What we've shifted to do that? How are our revenues at $400 million with 60 employees? Things like that people want to know. But just to get a feel, just maybe some question from you guys as to what's your ambition for the reason that you're in this class? What are you trying to accomplish out of this class or out of your business? So anybody that...
I'll start. I think I'm looking for, certainly there's just networking and, kind of for me being new to entrepreneurship, kind of understanding what are the common threads to successful entrepreneurs, what are the things that are common amongst those that are successful. But then further, what I hope for that happens in this program is some form of like think tanking, collaboration, ways that we're looking to the future.
Yeah, great. And I will say, since the time I was about five, and this story's been told to me by my mom many times, I was driving in a car with my mom, and I remember the location. So I was living in Portland, Maine, driving down a street, and there was a little variety store on one of the corners. It was called Patches, and it was a vacant lot diagonally across the corner. And I told my mom I wanted to start a variety store on the opposite corner, and she asked me why, and I said, well, I want to drive that one out of business. And it's kind of typified for what I've looked at my entire life. I have been very competitive, and I've also started a lot of businesses. FLS by far is the most successful, but I've done some that have done well and some that have not done well. I've had several failures. And even within FLS Energy, I've had a lot of ups and downs. Solar has been a very, people call it the solar coaster. It's very up and down, and our company has followed that. And we're right now riding on a very large upside because the costs have come down so much. And I think, as we look at even just to the name of the company, so basically I sat down, I met a friend, and I told him I was thinking about doing a solar company. And he said, hey, I think I could get involved in that. So I went home that night and I wrote a business plan. And I was trying to come up with a name because you got to have something. So FLS just stands for the three founders, Freudenberger, Le Guin, Shore. And I called it energy because I didn't want to call it solar, even though we knew we were going to do solar, because there was all kinds of renewable energy out there, and I didn't know what path we were really going to take. So there was a lot of debate around that. What is the company? Why aren't you calling it solar? Why isn't solar in the company name? And in those early years when we first started, we started as a solar thermal company, and that's when we got our exposure to Western Carolina, because we were innovating technology and trying to figure out where we fit into the world of solar. But we also did geothermal, and we did hydro, and we did wind, and we did energy efficiency, and I'm probably missing about 10 things. Anything that could bring in money to survive early on, we did. And then somewhere along the way, maybe 2 or 3 years in, we said, we've got to start picking and focus. And we chose solar thermal because it was a business model that we could mimic what was going on in California with North Carolina regulations. So we were able to sell energy direct to a building or a facility, where in California they can sell electricity direct. We're not allowed to sell electricity in North Carolina direct to an end user. But so we did solar thermal and we sold BTUs. And by doing that, it enabled us to bring a business model that was in California and bring it to North Carolina. So all of the big banks and all of the big institutions that were investing in California found a new market here in North Carolina through FLS. So we closed the first tax equity deals, we installed the first solar systems, we did the first landfill, a whole bunch of firsts, but they were very small. And then if you think about our value proposition at the time, we were competing against natural gas. And natural gas was $1.40 a therm, or very, very high price. And solar PV was also very expensive. When we first started, solar PV was about $10 a watt. Our first system that we installed, we charged, as a comparison, $10 a watt. We're doing that right now for about $1. So the cost savings have just been enormous in the last 8 years. So those two things were happening at the same time. Natural gas went from $1.40 to about where it is now, you know, 50 cents or so. And solar PV was coming down also. And at some point, those two things crossed. And it became more cost effective and more efficient to do solar PV to produce energy than to do the solar thermal. And that sounds real easy, but that's pretty tumultuous to a company that's focused solely on solar thermal. We were number one in the country for solar thermal in 2010, 2011. And that's how everybody knew us. So that's the, you know, that is the struggle that we went through. We had 80 employees. We were doing all our, you know, a lot of our construction ourselves. And we had to figure out how to regroup and get into the next thing. And we went into solar thermal. And I'm obviously jumping way ahead of my slide program here. So I'll just see if I can catch up. Not that it even matters too much. We don't need the pictures of that. So just to recap, and even this slide is a little off now, that I think they updated it at the beginning of last month. So we have about 70 employees now. We will be 80 in a month or so, 100 by mid-February. And when we look at those numbers, what we're trying to do now is to build for next year. So in 2015, we'll do about $400 million of revenue. I think it says $375 there. We have a lot of control over how much revenue we recognize in different periods. So depending on the tax bill, we'll recognize $375 or $400 million of revenue. With about 70 employees, technically 10 of those employees are just recent hires that we're gearing up for next year. We expect to do about $1 billion next year, and the year after that, maybe $1.5 billion to $2 billion, depending on what we take on for markets. Next year is pretty much in the bank. We're closing financing transactions now for next year, and just looking at the numbers, maybe the bottom here, we have sourced about $800 million of project capital. So that's capital for the projects that you saw in the video that are here in North Carolina. Most of it is in the state. So when you hear that we have a $2 billion industry in North Carolina, we've raised about $800 million of that and have put that into projects. And that's where the real job growth has been. So we have about 500 people working on sites right now through electrical contractors and grading contractors and installation crews and all that. So we don't keep that in-house anymore. And then the pipeline there is a little bit small, but that doesn't matter too much. I think here's a couple things that I wanted to point out. We had to go through the whole rigmarole for what's our value proposition, what's our business model, who's our target market, where are we going to do business. But the most important thing for us that came down is recognizing who are we as a company and what are we good at. Early on, I would have said we were a construction company, and then maybe at some point I switched over and said, well, we're a finance company, and today I say we're a project company. So anything that has to do with a project, and this is how we set all our systems up, is how to move a project from idea all the way through ownership and asset management. And this kind of just represents all the different stages from financing, project management and development, all the way down through operations and ongoing O&M on the project. And I think the thing that we were unique, certainly on the East Coast and maybe across the country, is that for a company of our size, we incorporated all of those features, and it allowed us to have a feedback loop that was very beneficial in the early days trying to drive down costs. And the other thing that it did is where we have the installation, so the EPC functions, we decided that we were going to take all our profits from our EPC and roll them back into the projects and build more. So the only thing we were really interested in was the revenue off the long-term ownership of the assets. That's how we judge ourselves for a while. And we did that, and we tried not to run out of cash. And those are the two competing interests that we had. So today, we've got multiple sources of income. And I think as we look at this, you know, you can make profit by having folks that are working for you and make money off their wages, or you can have some type of reoccurring revenue. We did choose to do reoccurring revenue. So as we have right now is we have the contracting profit, that's the EPC when we're building an asset for ourselves, basically. We have asset management income, that's when we charge ourselves to take care of our own assets. So O&M work is charged to one company, back to the other company, so everything flows up to FLS. And then the equity and the ownership income. This is what has taken my value of a $40,000 investment and turned it into a $200 million company. So our valuation that we had done in June pegged us at the revenue streams that we have now at about $200 million. So it's been a phenomenal growth, and most of that's come in the last 2 years. So this is what I was kind of hitting on before. If you just take sources and uses of a project or a bundle, for us, we have state equity and federal equity and debt that we can roll into a project to fund it. And then on the other side, of course, we have direct costs. So material and labor going out, we've got overhead, and what we've always tried to do is have some cash profit, because we've got to be able to fund working capital. So all our projects up until about 3 weeks ago flowed with positive cash flow. And when they don't flow positive cash flow, we got to make up that gap. So every time we put some money into a project, we got to figure that out. But the big chunk of our profit has been reinvested over the years. And what that does, it's hard to get this from this chart, but that creates a phantom tax bill. So we have one entity that's recognizing a lot of revenue, and then another entity that's sucking it all away. And we try to figure out how to cover that tax bill. We got very lucky because of bonus depreciation. I don't know if folks know that, but there's a bonus depreciation pass. So anytime there's a capital investment, you could take 100% bonus depreciation, then 50%, and 50%. Last year, they passed bonus depreciation with the 2 weeks left in the year. We had invested about $100 million, and we had an automatic $50 million deduction on our tax bill. And it has set us up very, very well for this year to just launch. And that's part of the reason why we were able to double this year from 200 megawatts to 400 megawatts. This slide only takes about an hour. So when I was in China, one of the things that was really interesting over there is that culture. First time I've been over there, that culture, they decide they want to do a city, they build a city. They decide they want to do solar, they do solar. And I was staying in Shanghai, Pudong, which is a region in Shanghai. And Dong means east, and Pu is the river. So east of the river, and as we're standing there, it's a very glitzy area, Maserati dealerships, Mercedes dealerships, lots and lots of money. And as we're standing there amongst 5 million people, they said this city did not exist 20 years ago. And the folks that I was presenting to basically said they built a road to the new airport from the river. And everyone was laughing at him, said, why'd you build a 6-lane highway? There's nobody, this farmland. And that was the start. So they build a highway, a freeway, and then all of a sudden that they just decided to build a city around it. And it is amazing the amount of construction and building that they do. So as I was presenting, they wanted to understand what we were doing and how we could take our business model and scale. We think we've scaled a lot, but when we talk to other people, they say, okay, how do you really scale this thing now? And so I described this as our freeway. This is our business process that takes a project from inception all the way through asset management. And each of the steps has a checklist and has a decision point and has a criteria for saying go, no go. And our entire reason for creating this was to move as many projects through the process as we could quickly while mitigating the risks that were in those process or in the projects. It was the last thing we want to do is spend money on a project that doesn't get to a point where we have 30 years of revenue out of it. So when you look at the diamonds, it's basically just a decision point, and each of these different things has a feedback loop. But it also, almost every point, has a checklist that goes with it. So what you're looking at here is probably, I'll say about 3,000 individual items that have to happen to get checked off before it moves to the next stage. And we have been very fortunate that I have some people that were able to set this up, because it has changed the way we operate. And as we move from North Carolina to the broader United States, and then beyond that, this is the type of thing that you need to have. You got to have your processes in place. It's great to say we got a value proposition, we got a business model, but if you can't execute on it, it won't happen. And when I put this slide up, I was presenting to a group in China, the largest utility in China. When I put that slide up, the chairman stopped and said, through a translator, said, you can have any market you want other than Asia. You tell me what you want, and I will make sure you have everything you need to make it happen there. So they even understand the processes, and it's something that not a lot of small companies or not a lot of companies spend time on. This is part of a broader data management and online tracking and all that. This is part of about a $1 million investment that we've made into the infrastructure of the company over the last, I'll say last 9 months or 10 months, and that has to continue. So I don't know if we need to spend much time on this. One thing that I have done that I like is I've kept our organization very, very flat. So myself and all of our VPs, we're basically called a VP team. So all decisions are made pretty much at the VP team. But what we've done recently, this is about a month old. So what we've done recently, though, is we've put another team of directors underneath here, that all the decisions that we made 3 months ago are now being made by the directors. And all the decisions that I was making 3 months ago are now being made by the VPs. And I don't know what I'm doing. So I just go out and tell stories. But that's one of the keys that we have really had to focus on in order to be successful, is we've got to hire good people. So we have a deep, deep bench of talented folks that we can draw from internally, but we also have national search firms and that are looking for folks. I would say back in 2009 and 10, after the downturn, we didn't have a problem with that at all. We could just put an ad out on Monster and we'd have 100 applicants. And now we put a very specific ad out and we maybe get one or two. And then they say, you're in Asheville. And you know, there's some people that have heard of Asheville, and there's some people that say, I'm not even moving there. You know, but it has been a key part of our success to have folks in the organization know what our goals are and what our mission is and what we're trying to do, and then let them make the decisions. So most people in the organization, all the way down to folks that are installing on the field, they know what we're trying to accomplish, and they know what their authority is. And I really don't have to spend much time on details at all. Whereas 2 years ago, I was in the day-to-day cash, I was in the day-to-day projects, I knew almost every detail of the company. And when you have five or six talented people telling you that you're the bottleneck and you need to stop and get out, then that's time to do that. I show this because it's kind of interesting. When you're starting a company, we went until 2011 before we brought any external funding into the company other than project level debt and equity. So this is at the corporate, the parent. And maybe just to give a highlight, so we have FLS Energy, the C Corp, that sits above everything. And that's the company that we started. And then there's project companies and developers and EPC and all that. It's about 110 companies that run underneath FLS Energy Inc. So this is the ownership at FLS Energy Inc. And we went, as I said, until about 2011, and I took a mezz debt loan for $12 million. When I did that, it was at 18% interest, so true mezz debt. At the time, we were generating so much money off of our installation of our thermal systems that it was not even an issue. We could just pay that back. And then, of course, all the plans that you lay out just evaporated. So solar thermal disappeared, and we had to enter this new market of solar PV where the margins are much, much tighter, especially on the installation money. So in order to continue to grow, you've got to have a balance sheet that matches. And when you have mezz debt payments, $500,000 a month going out the door, and you're trying to get a $100 million loan from the bank, they don't really match all that well. So we had to convert, I went through a whole capital raise and was ready to use a private equity firm. And I could just tell that they were going to take the company, and I knew what the company was capable of doing, but they were going to take all the profits. It was going to be, you know, an 80-20 deal. Management team was going to get shortchanged on that. And I could see what they were trying to do. They were trying to run us out of cash and then come in with a new deal. So we have a pretty intricate cash flow model that we use in a cash forecast, very, very detailed, with all the different companies coming in. So I pulled $1 million out of that, and I put it in the back. And they didn't know it, which shows how sophisticated they were in analyzing that. So we would say to them, hey, we're gonna be running out of cash on March 3rd or whatever the day was. It was March 4th. And lo and behold, March 5th came back. They thought we were out of cash, and they said, here's the new deal. And it was exactly what we expected. They were going to really shaft us at that point. And in the meantime, I had stashed $1 million, and I had figured out a new way to recapitalize without having to go through private equity. So what I ended up doing was refinancing the debt with our current partners. And in order to do that, I had to give up about 50% of the company. So, and I brought in, I had met one other group that I brought in for $1 million or $2 million here. And then I took the rest and took what I had and divided it out. So almost every single employee at FLS Energy owns some shares now. They're restricted stock, but everyone is incentivized to get to that bottom line revenue. This group, New Energy Capital, this will be their best investment they've ever made. It's taken them a year since they did the conversion, and they'll have about a 6x or maybe an 8x, depending on how things go on an exit. But it is clearly one of their best investments. And then it's worked out really well for the management team, the employees, and the founders that are still involved. The one thing I'll say about that is anybody that's taken mezz debt money or equity money or any of that, as soon as you do that, you're not working for yourself. And it was, you know, it was a little bit of a mind shift for us because it was, we were making decisions all the time ourselves. And as soon as we brought the discipline in of somebody that had put $12 million of their own money in the company, it changed the way we had to run the company some. As it turns out now, as we're in the middle of another capital raise, a big capital raise, this group has been our biggest advocate. So when you can bring your equity partner into a room with a new group and say, this is the team, this is the group you want to do, all you need to do is give them the money and give them freedom, and they'll execute. It is it's a great way to raise new money. And I don't know, I don't have much else here. Couple of the points that I touched on, and I don't know how we do on time, so we'll have some time for questions, and I can keep talking for hours if you want me to, but I was hoping to leave the floor open a little bit. I would say a couple things that to take away is hiring correctly, and one of the things that I have historically done is almost the opposite. I hire very fast, and I fire very slow, and it has been had to be ingrained into me to swap that around. Hire slowly, analyze it, get the right fit. And most of the time, once you vet the intelligence part, which is easy, it's the cultural part that takes a little bit more vetting. You got to get them with the team. And I have kept people too long. So my current advisor that I have definitely likens it to a stone in your shoe. And he always laughs and says, how many times have you come to me and complained about the way this person's operating with the team, and you've tried to do this, you've tried to do that. Why is this person here? Why are you spending any of your time on it? And it's a true fact. People that I would have said, this company will not run if I get rid of that person. 2 days after they're gone, the company's running better. And I have kept people for years with that mistake. And then there's always somebody out there. But it is hard to hire the right fit. And it is easy to screen the intelligence and the resume, that kind of stuff. It's hard to find the right folks. And then the other thing I say has been the one real key to our success is managing cash. You got to know where your cash is. You got to know when you're going to run out of cash. You got to know where the new money is coming in. And that has really been the focus of my job, I would say, over the last 8 years, 10 years since we started the company. I always worried about cash and I always watched it. But now it's my job to actually bring in the money. So it is a 2-year look now. We say, well, if we're going to try to do $1 billion next year, how much working capital do we need? And when you go to somebody and tell them you need $300 or $400 million of working capital, you got to have the data to back that up. So it is all in projections, all in managing the cash. So I have a couple of things I go over, but maybe we'll take a quick stop on me talking and just see if there's any questions from folks.
Yeah, so you mentioned that you have, I guess, two primary companies, one that manages the assets that the other one builds, right?
Yep.
So that's the revenue that you guys can play with when you recognize it?
So there's a couple ways to do that. So we have if you think of three buckets, we have a development company that goes out and generates the sites.
Right.
We have an EPC that engineers them, constructs them. And then we have a holdco that holds the assets and does the asset management. All of the high-level revenue comes from the power grid. So almost all of it comes from Duke Energy or Dominion or Progress or whoever the off-taker is. And so that revenue then goes where? And the question is, when you have investors especially on the tax equity deals, you don't want leakage of cash going back to an investor that's in just for the benefits of a tax investment. So that cash then can get sucked up in the asset management by charging an accounting fee or by charging a O&M fee or something along those lines. And so you can put some cash here, and you can put cash in the EPC for whatever you build the project for. And there are guidelines as to how much markup you can have on a typical construction, but we get that markup plus, you know, we're high market kind of thing. And then the development company can, with the revenue guidelines, can do between 15 and 20% of the value of the project. They can recognize that as revenue. So what we do is they say, instead of taking that cash today, we'll take that over 10 years. So we do a deferred development agreement, and it allows us to pull revenue out of the project over time. So all three of those, the EPC is quick hit, because you do it when you build it, and then the asset management DevCo can have money coming in for 10 or 15 years.
So you guys have a bunch of deferred revenue on your
balance sheet? A lot of deferred revenue, yep. I don't know, 100 million, 200 million, I don't know what it is. It may be more, actually it's probably more than that. Yeah. Net present value of that deferred revenue stream is over $200 million at a 7.5 discount, so whatever that is.
So how important are solar tax credits to your business currently? And how much time do you spend in Raleigh lobbying for favorable legislation?
That's a great question. In 2008 and 10, we could not exist without the state and federal credit. In 2015, we don't need the state credit. In 2018, we won't need the federal credit. Policy, though, is very important. And so this year, I wrote a bill. I think I started in December, and it passed the House and Senate and was signed by the governor in March. And by the time it got to the governor's desk, he's like, where did this thing come from? I found it very easy to work in Raleigh if you have a true business case and there's something that's in legislation that doesn't jive with what you're trying to do. So I found it easy to work with folks on both sides, but it's very important. I don't spend a lot of time. I have two people that spend time there. And the tax policy, though, right now we're sitting on a budget that hasn't been passed. And there's two opposing items in that are good or bad for solar. One's an RPS freeze, where they freeze the renewable portfolio standard, which has been the key driver to solar being in North Carolina. And the other one is the extension of the tax credits. And so the one bill was one that I participated in and kind of got slowed down in the Senate, and then this other tax credit. We don't really need it for certainly the scale that we do. Residential and commercial may need a tax credit. But all in all, the costs are just coming down so much, and the efficiency has gone up so much that it's not the same world as it was 5 or 6 years ago. And if you look at the goals of the North Carolina tax credit that they did, they wanted to create a market to drive down the costs. And we are so far below anything that they put in their initial charts that they've done. It's a great example of a public policy being used by entrepreneurs, and some of us succeeded and some of us failed, to do just what they wanted us to do. And it is, for me, I look at it and say, we've been told for 10 years, I don't know how long they've been in effect, the real amount, but when they did the extension, it was 6 or 8 years. So we've been told for 8 years that they're going to expire and you better get ready for it. And that's what we've done. And I think that is, you know, I don't want to keep going back to the till, because we don't need to.
On the project management slide, I could have spent an hour. So did you follow a particular model? Did you hire someone? Did your team come up with that?
The flow is, you know, you can get that off almost anywhere. Right. But it was internal team. So I had someone, actually, she used to be my assistant, but now she doesn't even talk to me. But she does all that, and she sets up all the IT, and so we have all of that is on the web, so that anybody in any spot can go look at any information about any project and know exactly where that project is. And it has been kind of her mantra to do that. But it's all internally developed, because it's very, all the checks are very specific to what we're doing. But it was a big investment for sure. It is, and I've used a couple different people, and I've actually gone back to the guy. You remember Mountain BizWorks? You guys are all familiar with that? And we got our first loan from Mountain BizWorks for $50,000, and they hooked us up with a group called NCIF, or Natural Capital Investment, down in Raleigh, or Durham. And they gave us $200,000, so $250,000 total, early on, like 2008 or so. And the gentleman that came in, his name was Bob Dunn, and he came in, told me, first question he asked me, when are you going to run out of cash? I said, well, I don't know. When I run out of cash, I put more in. He said, you're not going to be able to do that very long. So he was the one that got me started on the cash flow. And he has kind of morphed from an advisor that has he's very varied background, very technical in his advice, to now I just literally meet him every Tuesday at 3 o'clock. We have a beer at the Chestnut. And I tell him, here's what I think I'm facing this week, and how do I address some of these issues. And we're kind of morphing it in, because my role has really gone from worrying about the technical details, that's my tendency. I tend to dig deep and go into I want to know what's going on and everything, to having to tell a story and having to raise capital. I need to be able to kind of spit out what the heck we do in a very complex business model and explain it very, very high level. So he helps me with that kind of stuff. But definitely, he's an outside the company, but someone that knows the company very well. So he's been engaged with us for about 7 or 8 years.
Goes down in cost, what does that do to your model? At some point in time, we lose parts of the concern?
Not anymore. Solar is the lowest cost source of new power in the country. We'd be natural gas, nuke, coal, all of it. But that doesn't mean we should do all solar. It's a great power. It is a efficient use of land and space and resources, but it doesn't work well at night. And even the storage items that you have now, you know, I'd love to get into storage, but then there's a lot going on, but it doesn't make sense to me to put lithium batteries out on a field that are, you know, that are being mined in China and creating pollution. Let's figure out some other storage system. And in the meantime, let's use the resources that we have. You know, I'm not big on coal because of the pollution, but nuclear is a great baseload, and that's probably the wrong room to say that, but it is, you know, it's a mix. And if you get solar to about, I'll say 15-20% of the grid, there can be some issues with the grid getting out of balance because of the, you know, intermittent nature of it, but it depends on how much wind and solar you have in other stable processes. So I think it fits, and if you look at North Carolina or the country as a whole, all the solar that's been going on, we're still only getting about 1-2% of our total energy from solar. So there's a huge market potential without any disruption to any of the technology that's out there. And it's worked really well for Duke and TVA and others as they're retiring these coal plants to supplement the grid during the peak times, you know, morning and afternoon on peak demand. So.
I don't know if you have a technical background or more of a business background, but in the early stages of your venture, how did you acquire the talent in order to launch such a complex but yet successful business? Because there's a lot of moving parts. How did you acquire those people and bring them into the mix?
It's a great question, and I think maybe in a business. Actually, we'll talk, because this gentleman back here, he's a big engineer. My love and background is engineering, but when I was young, I had two brothers that were going to engineering school, and they sucked all the money out of the family. And so I was working when I was in junior high school and high school. I was working and putting money into the family. And so when I went to go to college, it was, my choices were more narrow than what my brothers. So I went to business school, but I my tendency is to lean more mechanical. And so I have a brother who's a nuclear engineer, and I read nuclear manuals and try to quiz him on it and stuff like that. So I have a pretty good understanding of what's going on. But my training is business, but I loved accounting when I got into it. And so in school, accounting was the place that I wanted to go. I was going to be, first stock market and then a controller and all that. And I got my wish after school. I got to be a controller after, 2 years in the workforce. And then I got put in a little tiny room with pink walls and a desk and put a stack of papers that big. And I analyzed financial statements and reported out for 6 months. And I went, oh, my gosh, this is not what I want to do. So background is definitely business, and then I had the technical ability. So when we first started a lot of these models, I created a lot of the training infrastructure for the team, and could understand all of the complexities of an inverted lease and where money flows and how it goes back and forth between companies and where you can pull out revenue from each of that. So I had a pretty good understanding of that. And then most of that, because it was such a specialized skill early on, was just out in the networking circuit. So when you're out at a conference, especially when I would hear somebody speak, that I wouldn't want whatever that, if I saw somebody that was speaking, I wouldn't want that person to be telling somebody else what they were telling. I would go see if I could hire them. And that worked out pretty well at the very beginning, and it was a little bit of a mismatch. But if there was someone that was an expert in the industry in any sector, I would try to get them. And that's how we brought on our lawyer, who was working for another firm in Winston-Salem. And then she took the ideas and created the whole platform, and she ran with it. And just, you pick smart people and try to bird dog them until they come work for you.
So as you add the 30 more, you're going to add 50% more staff by mid-February. How are you going to go about hiring? What are the key positions, and what's the strategy for getting these folks?
So we have different levels, and if we went back to the org chart, the VP level, we need to hire two folks there that are very specialized. We've hired an outside national firm to do that. And they're recruiting. We're getting good resumes. In the mid-level, what we call directors, is sort of managers, we've sourced it all over the place. We source it from, Monster or any of those, but also networking. So we have a lot of folks that just are out there networking and finding out what talent's coming up. And most of the people that we're bringing in, this is such a unique business, we had to train them anyway. So it takes a few months. So when we're saying we're hiring that many folks in the next 4 months, we don't expect them to be productive until halfway through next year. And then I would say on the force that's out kind of hands-on, it's just any way we can get people and then train them up. We've gone from job fairs to temporary job placement services and all that kind of stuff, just every way we can. But we have one HR person that has two people working under her that, sometimes their full-time job is just to hire people. Yes.
What is it?
Sell. I'm being a little sarcastic. We've looked at IPO. We've looked at other things. We were thinking to do a real IPO. We need about $50 million of reoccurring revenue on an annual basis. We're a little below that, and then we'd want to be able to have growth to put into that. We could achieve that next year, but the other side is this is a very complex business model and very complex accounting. So we have lawyers and accountants that we're dealing with all the time. And it makes for a hard story to audit through Ernst & Young or any like the Deloitte or anybody that's going to take you public. We could sit on it, but then as I told you, if you want to monetize a 20 or 30 year cash flow stream, are you going to wait that long or are you going to just let somebody discount it and take a payday kind of thing? We've looked at all that. And I think that it's likely that we'll be bringing in substantial investment into the company. And as we've looked at those different options, there's many different ways you can do it. But we're certainly gearing up. We need money to continue to grow. And then there has to be some exit event. And I would say that's one of the things that we talked about early on when my two other partners is, what's going to be the end game here? Are we happy if we just have to sit on revenue? Are we happy if we're just building this little company that three of us are working on for 10 years and that kind of stuff? And knowing... it helps knowing where your motivation is for that when you're starting. Because if you don't care about scale, if you don't care about the exit, then just go get something. Worry about the kind of current revenue.
On that same point, you mentioned motivation. I mean, what gets you out of bed each morning? What is your motivation?
That's a great question. When I tell people at work the story that I told you at the beginning.
I hope it's more than just an exit. That's what I'm asking.
No, it's never really been about exit, but you got to have a plan. Otherwise, you'd either squander some of it. But it has always been about the company building a business and beating other companies, for me. Solar is great. I love it. We have people that are totally dedicated to solar. I think we're doing a great thing for the environment and all that. But what drives me is the processes and finding out that we have moved up the notch in the rankings. So this year, we're number 4 in the nation as solar developers. And it's last year, we were number 19. So that's what drives it for me. Then we exit.
Okay. So.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep.
Can you comment on mistakes you've made?
Oh yeah. How much time do we have? Actually, how much time do we have? A couple more minutes. Zen. It's when you're in, especially when you're in business with friends, it can be very hard to make tough decisions, and I took over as CEO in 2000. I don't know what year it was, 2010 or 11. And prior to that time, we had an engineer that was in the position, and I was kind of doing the operations. And it was very hard. It was getting to the point where we could see that there was a downturn really coming. And it was very hard to make that transition. And when we finally sat down with my partner, said, we got to make a swap here. It was, from that point, it was very easy. Because it turns out that he was like, wow. He was sort of over his head, didn't know what to do. And so it's very important that you kind of have those conversations. I would say we've also spent money where we shouldn't. That's probably the worst mistake we've made. We did a project in Raleigh that we invested $1 million in, taking a chance on a grant that was going to come from the federal government. And when the grant came in, they deducted a whole bunch of money out of it. And the 1603, I know you're probably familiar with that, but it really hurt us. And then we had another project that we kind of banked and said, well, we're going to get the depreciation on this. And we put a couple million bucks into that. And then when that didn't come in, it was about a $3 million swing in 3 months. And that's sort of hard to explain to your investors. So watching the risk all the time and mitigating those and figuring out how to manage the risk and also portray to investors what the risks are that you're taking. And I think that's one of the things, maybe the biggest thing is when you do have an investor, is making sure that they're informed. Because there were a couple times that we did something like that we took a chance, a calculated risk, but the investor wasn't on the same page as we were, maybe we'll call it that. And so when we had to call back and say, oh, by the way, we just took $1 million ding, that's a fun call. And then just hiring mistakes, being in the wrong market, maybe not reacting quick enough when we saw solar thermal, when When you see futures on gas prices going to stay down at half of what they are or a third of what they are now, not reacting quick enough to find a different market, that costs us about a year. And I would say the biggest thing for me has been worrying too much about what is happening on a very detailed level and not just allowing to know that, hey, if I hire someone that's a lot smarter than me that's going to do this, there's something else for me. And it's been sometimes I've been very reluctant to let go. And every time I get kicked out, and that's what happens, they have to kick me out. Every time that happens, I go find what's the next thing to do. And it has worked out extremely well very quickly.
Oh. So much potential here in the U.S., why go to China? What was the reason?
Almost all of the raw materials now are coming from China. And if you look at our business model now, it starts at the conception of a project. But I have very little, all the way through construction, I have very little control over the raw materials in the panel and the sourcing of those. And sometimes it's just availability. So the reason to go to China is to make relationships, to figure out how to do a joint venture that allows us to get 3-year sight on material and no pricing for material. And then also to know that I can get that, we'll just call it a few percent cheaper than anybody else, and to have a competitive advantage. So if you look, we're number 4 in the country. If you look at number 1, they're vertically integrated all the way through manufacturing. If you look at number 2, they're integrated all the way through manufacturing of the panels, and the same as the other. And if you look at number 3, they're just a giant utility that does everything. And we're number 4. The number 1 developer in the country has about 3,000 to 6,000 employees. Number 2 has a 6,000 or 8,000 employees. Number 3 has 10,000. Number 4 has 60. So we have to be strategic about what we're doing with our resources. And that is about the next couple of years, kind of securing what we can get for materials. Oh, okay.
There's a push in a lot of communities like Austin, Texas has mandated gray yep. water for commercial and industrial. Have you seen any similar mandates try to get pushed through for solar?
Absolutely. There was one in Austin. And they were trying to raise enough projects to do 600 megawatts. So it's thousands and thousands of home equivalent. And what we call renewable portfolio standard, a lot of states have those, and they're mandates to the utilities that tell them how much of their energy has to come from renewable sources. And then generally of those, there's some that have a solar carve out. So North Carolina is one of the states that did that, and that's what enabled us to have a market. California has it, the Northeast has it, so there's lots of states.
That's continuing to grow.
There's pressure on it. There are some groups out there that don't like that because the idea originally with that, when you do a renewable portfolio standard, it allows for an ability for the utility to pay a little extra for the energy that they get. So back in 2007 and 8, when we had to charge $10 a watt to get these things installed, the utility was paying us 24 cents a kilowatt hour for that. So think how upside down that is in the world when you're paying 10 or 9 or whatever it is for your power, and the utility's paying us 24 cents to generate that. Now, we're all the way down to just avoided cost. So whatever the market can pay, whether it's from coal or nuke or whatever, that avoided cost that the utility calculates, that's what we get paid. So it's 5.5 cents or something like that. So the utility is making their markup on the energy that they buy from us now. But that's where the growth is just large volume, normal margins for business. There's no more of that big giant spread. Now there are states that are putting those in place, like New York is putting some of those in place because they were worried after Sandy, the hurricane, they were worried about the ability to have a distributed generation grid. So they're doing it more for that reason than any other reason. So, and I know you've had your hand up.
Well, you talked about your mistakes. Talk about your successes. How did you succeed when some of your competitors did not?
two keys. Under-promise. All under-promise. Always under-promise. And over-deliver. And I know that sounds so cliche, but we routinely do that. We have a joke in our office all the way through everybody's sandbags. And then now I have to try to figure out how much they're sandbagging so I know what really is going to happen. But it is, on the construction side, we have, up until this summer, we never missed a deadline. And we're always on time, on budget. And as soon as you do that, people are willing to give you a lot. Especially in the solar space, because there were so many people who were just bragging about what they were going to do, and they never executed. So even at a small scale, when we said we're going to do one project and we're going to get it done by the end of June, and we did that, we got to go back to the banks. And so that was our key into the Bank of America and the U.S. Bank and the big insurance companies to have them come give us repeat investments.
How does the triple bottom line affect your overall business model?
Well, we've been lucky that we have been able to generate a lot of cash. so that it's been easy to do that. And when we say our staff volunteers, it's really, we call it mandateering. Everybody has to volunteer. So we do that. We do a lot with giving back to different groups like Asheville Go here locally. We recently just supported a kind of pay it forward fund for policymakers, where we benefited early on from some of the policy that was done on our behalf. We've set up a fund that allows our success to feed the next thing, whether it's battery storage or water or any of that stuff where they need some regulation. And then on the staff, I don't know if you guys saw in the video, we had one of the word grams there. And we try to do a lot of stuff that's fun with the staff. And it is from having beer on Thursday afternoons when we have a company all-staff meeting where we're serving some beverages and, you know, just different activities and really watching the balance between the workload and the ability for people to have time off and all. And then the planet is, I mean, that's a pretty easy one for us because we're doing solar energy, so that's kind of a checkoff, and then I focus on the other two. So, but for us, we've never really focused on the money. It's there. We focus on it when it's not there, for sure. But we've never set up everything to say, oh, it's only about the money.
Do you have any thoughts on, like, B Corp?
Yeah. We looked at it, but it's too complex for what we're trying to do. And I look at it and say, I don't quite understand what the social goal is for it. Why don't you just do it? Say you're a for-profit business and take some of your earnings and put it into the things that you want to do that are good and just keep it easy. Mm-hmm. That's, I mean, I'm one person, so it's...
I don't know. Yeah.
It was too complex for us. We must be getting close on time anyway, right?
About but
a minute left.
Yep.
Anybody else? Well, that worked out perfect. So thank you.